Jesse Mims, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize thee, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death. Amanda Mincy, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize thee, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death. Raised to new life. Cole Deloach, in obedience to the command of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and upon your profession of faith in him, I baptize thee, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, buried in the likeness of his death, raised to new life in Christ Jesus.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. We're going to sing the first, second, and last verse. Would you please stand?
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood.
Again, you all are going to sing the "What can wash away my sin" part, and you all are going to sing "Nothing but the blood of Jesus," and then we'll all sing the chorus together. A little challenge this morning. Let's see if you're awake. All right, let's go, Wanda. You ready?
What can wash away?
Oh,
longer to linger. We're going to sing the first, second, and last verse again. We're giving the preacher time to get out of his wet clothes into his Superman suit.
God's people said, amen. Thank you, Brother Martin, Miss Wanda. We'd like that Coosahatchee Orchestra. And thank you, choir and church, singing out those wonderful hymns. And thank you, Leslie, giving me that extra time, because I just can't move as fast as I used to could. But we rejoice. It's a happy day. It's always a great day. So I invite you now to take your Bible, go with me again to the Old Testament book of Judges, as we'll get back into our series. I've been calling unlikely heroes. And this morning from Judges 6, we're continuing to look at the life of Gideon. We want to begin our reading with verse 25. And this morning I'll be preaching on the subject revived and restored. And so let's read our text and follow the reading of God's holy, inspired, inerrant, infallible word with prayer. The Bible says in Judges 6, starting verse 25, "Now it came to pass the same night the Lord said to him," that is talking to Gideon, "take your father's young bull, the second bull of 7 years old, and tear down the altar of Baal that your father has, and cut down the wooden image that is beside it, and build an altar to the Lord your God on top of this rock in proper arrangement. Take the second bull and offer a burnt sacrifice with wood of the image which you shall cut down." So Gideon took 10 men from among his servants and did as the Lord had said to him. But because he feared his father's household and the men of the city too much to do it by day, he did it by night. And when the men of the city arose early in the morning, there was the altar of Baal torn down, and the wooden image was beside it was cut down. The second bull was being offered on the altar which had been built. So they said to one another, "Who has done this thing?" And when they inquired and asked, they said, "Gideon, the son of Joash, has done this thing." Then the men of the city said to Joash, bring out your son that he may die, because he has torn down the altar of Baal, and because he has cut down the wooden image that was beside it.
But Joash said to all who stood against him, "Would you plead for Baal? Would you save him? Let the one who would plead for him be put to death by morning. If he is God, let him plead for himself, because his altar has been torn down." Therefore, on that day, he called him that is called Gideon, Jerubbaal, saying, "Let Baal plead against him, because he has torn down his altar." Let us pray. God, our Father in heaven, Lord, I ask again for a fresh touch and fresh filling of the Holy Spirit, Lord, because apart from you in me, I couldn't do what I do. Lord, I pray I'll decrease and you will increase and you will just put your thoughts in my mind and your words in my mouth. And I just pray I'll preach the resurrection power of Jesus Christ so strong today, Lord, that any lost person under the sound of my voice will come under conviction about that and get saved today. But also, Lord, for any Christian, Lord, that maybe just have slipped away a little bit from you, Lord. Their fire for you has cooled down. May today that be revived and refired, a renewed commitment that needs to be made. Lord, we pray you bind the devil and any demon spirit, because the only spirit we want moving here today is the Holy Spirit. And I know the devil doesn't want this message preached, but it's not about him, it's about you. So, Lord, you have your way. May your glory and power just come down from heaven and fill our very soul. And may your will be done in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Before Gideon could lead the people of God to overthrow the Midianites that had terrorized them for 7 years, they had to undergo a spiritual awakening in the land of Israel. In other words, the people of God had to get right with God before they can really experience God's blessing of freedom to be empowered to do what God intended them for to do, to take the gospel to the world. And that's really still God's pattern today for his children. Before a spiritual awakening can happen throughout our nation and throughout our world, it definitely needs one. A spiritual awakening must first happen in the church, made up of God's people. And then out of the overflow of God's people getting revived, the results of that is more lost people can be reached for Jesus Christ. You see, a spiritual awakening or spiritual renewal among God's people has been happening all through the years of history. It happens from time to time as God sees that it's needed and begins to burden people's heart to seek him for that. For instance, there was a Jesus movement back in the 1960s and the early 70s. It was referred to as a Jesus Revolution, where all the hippies were started getting saved and their lives were getting changed. And some of you may remember those gatherings where they would play the big hit song of that day, "Bridge Over Troubled Waters," and then the preacher would get up and say to the crowd that Jesus Christ and his cross is the bridge between a lost sinner and holy God. And so as a result of that gospel being preached, there was a lot of folks that were lost and came under conviction. They got saved, but there was also a spiritual awakening, spiritual renewal among God's people who were saved that really ignited a revival fire in the church. And sometimes we refer to a spiritual renewal or a spiritual awakening among God's people as revival, which can only happen for God's people. And it can only be sent by God for God's people to do what God teaches us to do. And we're supposed to seek him for revival, because a spiritual revival or spiritual renewal from God's people is just basically when God's people fall in love with Jesus again and get their focus and their priorities right with God. And like I said, down through the years of history, there's been many spiritual awakenings, sometimes called a spiritual reformation. And that's what we see going on right now among God's people in this chapter of Judges under the leadership of Gideon. You see, a true spiritual reformation involves God's people just getting right with God, because sometimes God's people just need to put everything on pause and really do some personal soul searching and make sure that they're rightly related and totally surrendered to the lordship of Jesus Christ. That's why Paul taught us every time we do the Lord's Supper to do that self-examination. Because God's people, people who are saved, people who know better, sometimes can just let their guard down and get complacent, backslidden, or even involved in deep sin. Over in the book of Revelation, we see there was a church at Laodicea, and the message from the Lord to them was, "You folks need to repent. You need to get right, because you're lukewarm. You're not hot, you're not cold, but lukewarm," which made our Lord sick to his stomach. Then there was a church at Ephesus, and the Lord complimented them on their Bible preaching and teaching and their good works and services. "Hey, that's all good, but you've lost your first love." And so you folks need to repent and experience a true spiritual reformation to rekindle your fire and love for the Lord. And so I want to preach about that this morning, because we as God's people, the only way that we can ever touch the world or even touch our own communities that we have influence over with the saving gospel message of Jesus Christ is that we as God's people have to have our own life right with God. And sometimes God has to shake the church. Sometimes God has to shake the people of God with a spiritual reformation that really puts Jesus Christ in his proper place in our everyday life. And so I want you to notice three things about a spiritual reformation. First of all, I want to talk about where it begins. Where it begins. You see, a true spiritual reformation for a believer always begins in our own heart and in our own home. And the only way for a spiritual reformation in our own life and in our homes to take place is we have to make sure that we have no idols in our life or in our home. And remember what an idol is. A lot of times you think of an idol as something you bow down to, but an idol is anything, any person, any place that has taken God's first place position out of your life. So notice in verse 25, it came to pass on the same night, the Lord said to Gideon, take your father's young bull, the second bull of 7 years old, tear down the altar of Baal that your father has. That means this was in his own home. Cut down the wooden image that's beside it and build an altar there to the Lord. So this was obviously a violation of the word of God. Gideon's own father, in his own home, there was a clear violation of Scripture. In the Ten Commandments in Exodus 20, God makes it very clear, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself a carved image, any likeness of anything that's in heaven above, on the earth beneath, or in the water but under the earth. You shall not bow down to them. You shall not serve them. You shall have no idol, period. And then Paul in the New Testament, speaking to the church at Corinth, which was believers, he said, therefore, my beloved, flee from idolatry. In other words, the message from God to God's people was get rid of any type of idol or idols in your life. The Bible says flee idolatry. The fact is everybody is worshiping something. And so someone or something is on the throne of your heart right now. Sadly, too many times it's not the Creator who's the main focus or who's in charge of our life in our homes, but it's the creation. There's a lot of people today that worship the creation rather than the Creator. Some people will worship the blessings rather than the one who gives the blessings. And so I believe there's a clear process that you have to make in order to identify and remove any idol from your heart and your home before you can really experience a true spiritual reformation in your life. First, you have to search your own heart and just be honest with God and honest with yourself and ask yourself these questions. To what or whom am I giving my time and my first fruits? To what or whom am I giving my most efforts? To what or whom am I the most passionate for? And if your answer is not God, then you have an idol in your life. So you need to ask yourself, is there anything in my life right now that I should be saying no to, but I don't? That's an idol. We have to search our hearts and we have to get real honest and say, Lord, I just want to make sure there's nothing between me and you, Lord. Anything that I have put over you, reveal it to me, Lord. I understand I need to get rid of that. Or I need to stop making that first. You see, there are some things in life that may be good things. They're not bad within themselves, but they can become bad when you put those other things first place in your life that Jesus is supposed to have in your life. He's supposed to be first and foremost. And when you put something else in that place, whatever takes your focus from the Lord being priority in your life, that is an idol. And there's no idol that can heal your sick body. There's no idol that can meet your need, your financial need, physical, emotional, spiritual, whatever need you may have, whatever time when you're in those desperate times in life, no idol can meet that need. No idol will bring you through a rough patch in your marriage relationship or any family-related or friend relationship that may be fractured or damaged. No idol can help you with that. It's only the living God who can work through you and in you to meet whatever need you have according to His riches in glory. You see, we don't worship a God that's made with human hands. We worship the living God who made the planets, who made the stars and this entire universe. That's the God we worship. That's why we're supposed to search our hearts and identify any idol in our life and confront that idol immediately. So you got to name your idols one by one so that you can deal with those idols in your life. And remember this, an idol can be self, a hobby, people, money, material things, drugs, alcohol, pornography, popularity, lust. The list goes on what can be an idol or become idols in your life. So you have to ask yourself, what has taken God's place in my life? And then you have to be willing to do something about it quickly. Because the fact is, more and more people today who claim to be Christians no longer put God first in their life. And by the fruit of their life shows that they're not putting God first. Because when church life is no longer important to many of people who claim to be Christians who know better, that's a bad sign. Because today we're seeing a nationwide decline where people don't care about church anymore. Attending and serving and supporting church is not an interest in a lot of folks today. But listen, that's not man's idea. That's God's design and God's command for true born-again believers to receive Christ, be baptized, be added to the church. That's part of our growing in discipleship to grow and mature in the faith. That's God's design. But there's a growing problem in homes where people who claim to know Jesus Christ as their Savior, and they'll come to church every now and then, and they'll sing to Him, "I surrender all." And in many cases, in their own life, in their home, they're not totally surrendered to the Lordship of Christ. That means they're singing a lie, and they're living a lie. And according to the Word of God, lying in any shape or form from a Christian grieves the Holy Spirit of God, which is a sin against God, which will prevent you from ever experiencing a true revival in your life. So sometimes an idol may be a sport. Could be a deer stand, a bass boat, a ball game, some other interest, a hobby, some other human being. And none of those things are bad within itself. But anything, any person, any place that you elevate in your life, higher than your relationship to God, becomes an idol. And when God's not first place in your life, He's not in the right place. So when that happens, nothing else in your life is going to work. It's just not. God will not bless you as an individual. He'll not bless your home life. He'll not bless your career. He'll not bless your ministry if God is not first and foremost. But when your love for God is right, there's just that inner motivation to you. You want to obey God. You want to serve God. It's a blessing to you to serve God. When your love for God is right, it really, you're in a position to make wiser and much better decisions in your areas of responsibility. It just works that way. But when you have an idol, it causes you to fall for the weakness of the flesh and to be drawn to the desires of the flesh rather than the prompting and the convicting power of the Holy Spirit. And when a person begins to walk in the flesh instead of the Spirit, they're already on that downward path that could lead to disaster, if not total rock bottom, unless they get a Holy Spirit wake-up call, they hear that call, and they repent before it's too late. So where is God in your life today? If He's not first and foremost, I'm just telling you, love, you got an idol somewhere. You need to confront that very quickly. The fact is, there are a lot of people today, they get excited about everything else the world has to offer, except being excited for Jesus. When your love and passion for the Lord is not first and foremost, then your desire to honor and obey the Lord is just not going to be there. And that leads to that slippery slope. And it has a negative effect, not only you personally, but it has a negative effect on your home life. And if your home life is not in a good God-honoring order, then that's going to have a negative effect on everything else you do in life. So we as God's people have to search our hearts and identify any idol and confront them immediately with the effort to get rid of that idol. From the scriptures, we see Gideon not only identified the idols and confronted them, but he cut them down. The Bible says he cut that wood not into pieces, which brings us to the next step to experiencing a spiritual reformation in your home. You got to search your heart. You got to identify those idols. You got to confront them so you can get rid of them. That means you got to confess, repent, and forsake any form of idolatry. It's not just enough to identify it and regret it. Say, "Oh, I'm sorry I did that." You got to put it to death through simple repentance, true confession, because any idol in any shape or form, if you don't confess that, that means agreeing with God that it's a sin, then you're not going to get rid of it. Listen, Jesus didn't die on a cross and shed his blood for you and get buried in a barred tomb and get raised victorious from the dead for you to have a Christless, disobedient life when you know better. Jesus didn't save your soul for you to forget about God unless you have an emergency and treat him like a 911 operator. Jesus saved you so he wants to be Lord of your life. Jesus came out of that tomb. He had the keys to death, hell, and the grave. He came out of that tomb not only to be your Savior, but to be your Lord, the Lord of your life, Lord of your home, Lord of your marriage, Lord of your family, Lord of every role you have in life. Jesus Christ has to be number one in every area. His agenda has to be our agenda. His will must be our will. His aim must be our aim. That means for us as born-again believers to experience that true reformation, that true personal revival in our heart, in our home, we have to search our own hearts. We have to identify and confront those idols. We have to confess and forsake them and recommit our life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Notice verse 26. God told Gideon, build an altar to the Lord your God. In other words, remove and replace those idols and put Jesus Christ first and foremost on the throne of your heart and your home. And the altar of God for us is the cross of Jesus Christ. Christ alone is the divine substitute for the barren, lifeless, powerless, man-made gods that can be in our life. So to experience this true spiritual reformation, you got to put Jesus first and foremost. Center your personal life, center your marriage, center your family, center your career, your role as a parent, whatever role you have in life, whatever you do, wherever you go, Jesus has to be first over everything. That's what God's calling us to do, to experience a true spiritual reformation that will bear fruit and bear witness, no matter where we at, that we are true children of God that brings glory and honor to God. So where does it begin? It begins in our heart and it begins in our home. And you know what? When God gave this instruction to Gideon to remove the idols from God's people, you know what he did? He obeyed. Look at verse 27. Gideon took 10 men from among his servants and did as the Lord said to him, but because he feared his father's household and the men of the city too much to do it by day, he did it by night. In other words, even though Gideon was a little fearful there because he knew he had to do the right thing, but he's cleaning up his own house. He's going to have to go against his family on this. But he still did the right thing. And I'm sure, since Gideon's family was worshiping Baal, and these idols were in his home that he was raised up in, I'm sure he was thinking to himself, I know I need to obey God. I need to do what's right. And I know if I'm going to challenge the Midianites in the name of the Lord, I'm going to be defying my own father, my own family, my own neighbors, and the multitudes of people in Israel that are worshiping Baal. And so I'm sure, humanly, Gideon had his ups and downs, just like we all do. Because especially when you know people are making fun of you and they just don't want to hear about the truth of God's word. But I'm sure he was also rejoicing in the fact that God was planning on deliver Israel. But he was trembling at the fact that God called him to be the leader to do it. But he had to clean up his own home first. And so God knew Gideon was afraid and was really unsure of himself when he first called him to the task. So it's interesting that God started with Gideon right here at his home. So Gideon can see that God was seeing through this, which get him ready for a bigger battle ahead. And the fact is, what we learn is if we don't practice our faith at home, if we don't practice our faith in our private life that nobody else sees, then how can we practice our faith anyplace else where everybody sees? Gideon had to take a stand for God's truth in his own house before he dared to defeat the enemy on the battlefield where everybody could see it. And what we learn from God's word is a lot of times God gives his servants victories in private, smaller victories to prepare them for some greater victories in public. And you think about that, because think about David when he killed that giant Goliath in the sight of two armies. But you know, David had to learn, before that happened, he had to learn to trust God by killing a lion and killing a bear in a field where nobody saw it but God. The Bible tells us in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 25, when we prove that we are faithful with a few things, God will trust us then with greater things. So the Bible says, God told Gideon, tear down the altar. And he did. He tore down the wooden image. He cut that wooden image up. and used it for firewood to put God's sacrifice on the altar. So Gideon's response to God's command was obedience, even in his fear, even being in the minority with all the ungodliness around him. He did exactly what God told him to do. And so where does spiritual reformation begin? It begins in our heart. It begins in our home with a total surrender to the Lordship of Jesus Christ so that we walk in obedience to God, trusting God to see us through, to take a stand, to do what's right in the eyes of the Lord, whether it's popular or not, in the eyes of the world or even with our own family. Ultimately, our goal should be to please God. But if you live one way at church on Sunday but live for the world Monday through Saturday, it shows a big problem. One, it's either you've never been saved, or if you have been saved, you are very backslidden. And Jesus is definitely not first in your life, so you need a true spiritual reformation in your life to change that. So that brings us to the second point here in the Word of God. I want you to notice about a spiritual reformation. First, we talked about where it all begins, but now I want you to see who it offends. Who it offends. Anytime God seeks to do a spiritual awakening in the life of a Christian, you can call it revolution, you can call it reformation, you can call it revival, whereby the Holy Spirit stirs up a fire in God's people, just be aware, there are those who arise up and cease to douse the flames of any spiritual awakening. The devil loves to use negative, carnal, immature church people to try to cool off God's people who are on fire for the Lord. They say, oh my goodness, you need to calm down some. We're going to go off the deep end. We don't want to be too radical. Now, you know what amazes me? There are some church folks who will get upset when somebody says amen out loud. They'll get upset if someone says praise the Lord. They'll get upset if someone claps their hands or raises their hand and get happy in the Lord. Some people get upset and it bothers some people. And they get very upset about Christians who are very joyful and very expressive in their joy of the Lord. But them same folks don't see a bit of problem of jumping up and down and yelling and screaming at a ball game. Or you don't see them complaining that the music's loud at a country concert or a rock concert or a pop concert. But don't let the music get too loud in church. Amen. And those that complain about the temperature in the church too hot or too cold, they don't think nothing about going to a ball game on a 100-degree afternoon and the humidity is rot. I mean, you're just pouring sweat before you even get out the car, freezing rain, and they'll jump up and down and yell for their team or scream at the referees, clap, blow whistles, air horns. But yet they come into the house of God with a frown, sad sack, and sour, with their arms folded and say, preacher, bless me if you can, but hurry, I need to go home. Oh, I wish people would not sing so loud. I wish the preacher wouldn't preach so loud. I wish people would just calm down. We're in church, for goodness sakes. Yes, we're in church, but we're not at a funeral. Let me tell you, in love, I don't have a problem people getting excited at a ball game or watching some famous singer they like. If that thrills you, enjoy yourself. But just don't get mad or upset on Sunday if I get up behind this pulpit and I'm just a little excited about Jesus Christ because I'm thankful. He saved my soul, and I get the opportunity and to share the greatest news on earth that Jesus is alive, Jesus saves, and there's victory in Jesus. He's the one who sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. And I just want to let you know, when you get happy in Jesus, there's going to be those around you that's not. And they're going to try to discourage you from being happy. They'll call you a fanatic, or they'll call you some other name to try to cool your fire off for the Lord. Well, Gideon, he tore down the altars of Baal. Not everybody was happy about it. Look at verse 29. They said to one another, who's done this? And when they inquired and asked, they said, Gideon, the son of Joash, has done this thing. Now remember, these are Israelites. These are God's people, church members. They found out it was Gideon. Verse 30. Then the men of the city said to Joash, bring out your son that he may die, because he has torn down the altar of Baal, and because he has cut down the wooden image and was beside it. Now remember, the Bible says it was the prophets of Baal and the worshipers of Baal that was supposed to die. Those were the ones that were dishonoring God, not this godly believer who's leading this spiritual reformation among God's people. But obviously, there were some folks there that was a little concerned things was getting a little too spiritual. Now, they claimed to be worshipers, but they were worshiping the wrong God. They may have said they worshiped God with their mouth, or maybe with their mind, but they didn't have God in their heart. These are what you call religious people, but lost. Notice they say, bring out your son that he may die. He's torn down the altar of Baal because he has cut down the wooden image that was beside it. In other words, these religious people were upset with Gideon for tearing down and getting rid of a false god in their land. I mean, they were upset that Gideon was rocking the boat. He's doing something we've never done before. We don't want to go over the edge. But I want to tell you something. A natural person who's a lost person doesn't receive the things of the Spirit. Paul said to the Corinthian church, spiritual truth is only spiritually discerned. And so when you're in church and if you're not saved, I want you to understand there'll be some things you don't understand. You won't want to understand or experience the joy that there is in loving and serving and worshiping Jesus. You won't understand that until you get saved. And then there's a whole different feeling in your life. Any Christless religion is lifeless. It's joyless. Those things that entertain people's flesh don't last. But instead of these church folks saying, praise God, it's about time someone cut down these heathen altars and I'm going to go to my house now and I'm going to get things right with God. Thank God for whoever did this, for let's get in on this, let's do what's right. But they didn't rejoice what Gideon had done to take a stand for the one and true God. They resisted because those folks wanted to stay in that lost, sinful, separated from God condition. And I'm sure many of you have heard the prodigal son story in Luke 15. If you've been a Christian for any amount of time, I'm sure you heard that. But many people don't realize the whole point of that whole chapter. Luke 15 has been called the lost and found chapter in the Bible. Jesus gave three stories in that chapter. The parable of the lost sheep, where the shepherd leaves the 99 and goes after the one that was lost. And then the parable of the lost coin. That was the lady had the 10 silver coins and lost one. And she searched carefully until she found it. And then the prodigal son story where he lost his way and he was found. And so in that chapter, you got the lost sheep, the lost coin, the lost son. In each case, the lost was found and there was celebration. But you need to understand the audience that Jesus was talking to when he gave those three parables. In Luke 15:1, it says, then all the tax collectors and the sinners drew near to him to hear him. Now, those were the lost people. Those are the ones that didn't claim to be religious, didn't have any religious affiliation at all. They were lost sinners, and they were listening to Jesus to see what he had to say. But then in the verse 2, it says, the Pharisees and the scribes, those were the religious people. Those are folks that knew the law, and they complained about what Jesus was doing, just like the religious folks and judges was complaining what Gideon had done. And so they were just showing out in anger, who tore down this idol? Well, we get back to Luke 15, where the religious Pharisees and the scribes complained because Jesus was talking to the sinners, he was preaching and teaching the sinners, and went home and ate with them. Oh, that really got on their nerves. The Bible says that the Pharisees and scribes complained, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. So the religious crowd was upset with Jesus because he was talking with sinners, going home to eat with sinners. In verse 3 of Luke 15, Jesus then spoke the parable to them, speaking to who? The religious crowd, the one that was complaining what Jesus was doing. He gave them three parables. Talked about that man who left the 99. To go after the one lost sheep. And basically Jesus said, rejoice with me, because I have found my sheep which was lost. I say to you likewise, there's more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents over the 99 of persons who need no repentance. And then Jesus told him about the woman who had the 10 coins but lost that one and searched until she found it and then rejoiced. And Jesus said, well, that's basically what I'm doing. I'm searching for that person who's lost and needs to be found. And then he told the story about the man who had two sons. And one son wanted his inheritance early and went out and just wasted his life. Basically hit rock bottom before he came to his senses and came back home. And his father ran to him and hugged him and kissed him and welcomed him back home as if he never left. The father rejoiced because his lost son had come back home. And the father said, told the servant, bring out the robe and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet and go kill the fatted calf. We're going to have a big celebration because my son, who was lost, has now been found. So basically, Jesus told that story to drive home a point to those religious but lost Pharisees. That look, I'm seeking out lost sinners with unconditional love and forgiveness. And I want to celebrate when a lost sinner comes home get saved, just as the angels in heaven rejoice over one sinner. And you should be celebrating. You shouldn't be criticizing what's going on. So to emphasize this point, he talked about the other brother in the picture who didn't leave home. He was out there working in the field. He hears all the music and laughter and the dancing going on, and the closer he gets to the house, the louder it gets. And he calls one of his servants and says, "What in the world's going on there?" And he said, "Man, your brother's come back home. Your father's so happy and excited. He's throwing a big party. They've killed a fatted calf." And then the older brother got angry, and he wouldn't even go in for the celebration. Now, that only makes good sense, does it? The older brother is so angry and jealous, he wouldn't go in to see his younger brother who just came back home, a brother who was lost but now is found. So the father goes out and talks to the other brother, the older brother who's mad. And he says to his father, "I don't understand this. I've stayed home. I've obeyed everything you told me to do. I've always worked hard. I hadn't done any of these things that my younger brother's done. He spent all his money on harlots. He's wasted his life. I've stayed here and I've worked hard. I've been a good boy. I've never caused you any problem. You never throw me no big party." And his father said to the son, "You've always been with me, and all I have is yours. It was right for us to make merry and be glad because, listen, your brother was dead and now he's alive. He was lost, but now he's found." But you see, that anger and jealousy in that older brother shows us a problem. Because even though he lived a good life, even though he did the right things at home, he worked hard, he had religion, but he didn't have a relationship with Jesus. The lost son knew he was lost, came to his senses and went back to his father. The older son thought he was self-righteous, thought he was good enough on his own to deserve more than he got. His problem was he was religious, but lost. He knew about the Lord, but he didn't know the Lord, because there was anger and bitterness and resentful and jealousy all coming out. Remember, Jesus said, "By their fruit, you will know them." And that's a big problem with religion today. I always cringe when I ask somebody, "Are you saved?" And the first thing they tell me is what church they were a member of. I didn't ask you what church you were a member of. I didn't ask you if you were a Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, or whatever. I asked you, "Do you know Jesus?" There's a difference. Because being a member of a church roll is not going to get you to heaven. And there's a lot of folks on church rolls going to bust hell wide open because they've been playing church all their life. They think because their parents had them dedicated as a baby that they're going to heaven. They're going to be in for a rude awakening. Amen. Jesus said there's coming a day when religious people who know the truth but never have received the truth is going to tell the Lord all the things they've done. And Jesus said, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Not "I once knew you and you lost it." "I never knew you." I hope no one under here has to hear those words. But that's a problem with religion today, because there's people who think they're good enough. There's people who think they're better than other folks because they don't do certain things that sinners do. But listen, religion does not convert and cannot convert or change your life. Jesus said you must be born again. You must by faith come to Jesus, accept his saving grace, because good works and religion cannot ever save your soul. If it could, he wouldn't have had to come die for us. But the older brother was angry and jealous, and it showed he had an evil, sinful heart. So by that older brother complaining to his father about the celebrating the younger brother who was once lost and found, that was the same thing that the Pharisees and scribes were doing to Jesus as they complained about Jesus speaking with and eating with the sinners. And the main point of the story is the elder brother was just like the Pharisees and the scribes who criticized Jesus. They were the same as that lost one lamb out there. They were the same as that one lost silver coin. They was the same as that lost prodigal son before he was found. The elder brother, as well as the Pharisees and scribes, were lost in religion. And there's a lot of folks today in that category. They're lost in religion. As I told you, you can have your name on a church roll. You can be baptized, dedicated as a baby, sprinkled, immersed, know all the language of the church. But there's never been a time in your life where Jesus has come into your heart because you have not took that time to confess that you are a sinner and place your faith in Jesus Christ because of his death, his burial, his resurrection. That's the only gospel that can save a sinner. If you've never done that, then you haven't been changed yet on the inside. If that hasn't happened in your life, you only have the husk. You only have the outside in the shell. That means you're still empty on the inside. And there's a lot of people who are religious but lost. They don't see it. And they don't even get it. And these guys didn't get it because they were religious but lost. Why would anybody want a lifeless, joyless experience when you can know the real Jesus and he could be your personal Savior in your heart and in your home? And instead of walking through a religion that has fossilized your soul and blinded you to the truth that can set you free, why not just put your faith and trust in Jesus, who not only saves you and changes you and keeps you saved and guarantees you a place in heaven, but also allows you to experience the abundant life in Christ until you get to heaven? And when you get saved, then you get happy and rejoice with God's people when you see others get saved. When you see what God's doing throughout this world, saving people every day from hell, that's something to rejoice about. He revives his church, and he's reviving his church. And when I read reports of missionaries that are in Muslim countries and communist countries and countries that don't have near the freedoms that we have in America, and they're seeing a mighty move of God, a record number of souls coming to Jesus Christ, why can't we do that here? You know why? Because many of God's people are playing church. They're quenching the Holy Spirit. And we need to pray for a God-sent revival to revive his church so that God's kingdom work can continue to march on until Jesus comes, and he's coming soon. And if you know him, you'll be taken, but if you don't, you're going to be left. So when it comes down to spiritual reformation, I've said something where it all begins. I've said something who it offends, but last but not least, very quickly, how it ends. What is the end result of spiritual reformation? Well, when God's people get right with God and start doing right, you'll see more lost people get saved. It's just amazing. It's just interesting how when one person gets saved, it's like a domino effect. It's a chain reaction where other people start getting saved. Lydia got saved in Acts 16, and her whole family ended up getting saved. Philippian jailer got saved, and his whole family got saved. You see that chain reaction all the way through the Scriptures. Yes, there's those out there that don't like it, but there's other folks that are looking, they're seeking, they're looking for something to fill that emptiness in their life that nothing in this world can fill, only Jesus can fill it. And when they see Jesus is real in your life, it draws them to that. And they will say, I want what you have. I want that peace of God. And when a sinner gets saved, there's rejoicing among God's people, like y'all was rejoicing today over the baptism. And that attracts lost people who need to know Jesus and experience the true joy of knowing and worshiping and serving the Lord. So here's a man in Judges 6 named Joash, Gideon's father. And now technically, Gideon's father had every reason to be angry with his son like the other folks were mad, because this was his altar to Baal. Gideon smashed it, replaced it to an altar to God. Gideon sacrificed his father's prized bull to the Lord. But obviously, the Lord already done a work in Joash's heart. And he didn't complain about his son. He didn't jump on that crowd to criticize his son. He defended his son before the whole town. He even actually insulted the Baal god, the one he used to worship. Gideon's father Joash said to the people, look, folks, don't get mad at Gideon for destroying these idols. Obviously, Baal's not God. If he was a real God, he wouldn't need a bunch of guys like you to defend him. He could defend himself. And so because of Gideon's faith and stand for the Lord, it motivated his own father, who was once guilty and being caught up in idolatry. Now he's publicly declaring, from now on, I'm embracing the one true God. One and only. Baal's not the real God, folks. It's Jehovah God of the Bible. And when the spiritual reformation comes among God's people, what you see is lost people get saved. That starts a chain reaction whereby other lost people get saved. Christians rejoice, continue to grow stronger in the faith. And sometimes religious people that are lost, they get upset about that. That's just a fact of life. The devil loves to use those to try to quench the fire. But that's okay. Just remember, our goal in life as a born-again Christian is not to please people. It's to please God. And what I've learned, when you please God, people who love God, they're very pleased too. Well, when there's a spiritual reformation that takes place in the body of Christ, people outside the walls of the church, they see that we're true Christians. They sense it. It's obvious. There's no light. I mean, it's light or darkness. I mean, there's no guessing. There's no wonder in it. When Christ is real in your life bears witness. The Spirit in you bears witness that you are a true child of God. What the Bible says, they started calling Gideon this nickname, Jerubbaal. That means a Baal's antagonist. So when his father Joab said to the people, we're going to call him Jerubbaal. Now keep in mind, verse 32 says, let Baal plead against him because he has torn down his altar. In other words, what kind of God is Baal who can't defend himself? So with the nickname Jerubbaal given to Gideon, it was really not intended to compliment Gideon. But a lot of times, the unbelieving world will give us demeaning nicknames to faithful servants of God. I mean, that's just fact. People call us names all the time. D.L. Moody was called Crazy Moody when he was building his famous Sunday school in Chicago. And his legacy for being a godly man is still very strong today. And nobody in their right mind would call him crazy, but people back then did. Charles Spurgeon, the great British preacher, was frequently lampooned in the British press. And what's interesting is that born-again believers were first called Christians in Antioch. That was a nickname given to Christ followers by unbelievers. It wasn't intended to be a compliment. It was given to people that identified with Jesus, sing for Jesus, preach, teach for Jesus, serve Jesus, love Jesus, share their testimony. Oh, how Jesus has saved and changed my life. Share the gospel that Jesus can save you and Jesus is coming again. And the lost people in Antioch gave the Jesus people a nickname, Christian. It wasn't intended to be a compliment. But you know what? The reason why they called them a Christian, because they identified the people who followed Christ being different from the lost people in the world. Technically, that was not a bad name. We have taken it. We take it as an honor to be called a Christian, and we should. People who love Jesus, live for Jesus, should not be ashamed to be called Christian. Anytime we're given nicknames or called names because we choose to honor the Lord, we should wear that as a badge of honor because we should never be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ and never be ashamed to be identified as a Christian. Our focus in life should be to love, honor, and obey our Lord, to bring glory and honor to him in all that we say and do. So Gideon learned a valuable lesson. If he just obeyed the Lord, even in fear, the Lord would protect him. The Lord would guide him. And the Lord would lead him to victory, and the Lord would receive the glory. And there are times in the life of a born-again believer, in our individual life, in our home, as well as in the body of a church, that we just need that spiritual reformation to keep our love, our focus, our devotion, our service, our witness on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. And in the world we live in today, that takes a lot of spiritual discipline because it's easy to get discouraged. It's easy to want to throw your hands up and quit. So here's my challenge to you this morning. Search your heart. Identify if there's any idol in your life or in your home. Tear them down. Forsake them. Crown Jesus as King of your heart, King of your life, King of your home today. Do your part as a Christian to obey God at all costs. And by doing that, you could actually be a spark that sparks revival not only in your own life, but God could use it to spark a revival among the people of God in your church. And then God could use that to probably spark a national revival in our land that we desperately need to heal our land. But whatever, listen to this, beware. Don't be the cold water committee. Don't be the devil's team that cools down or tries to kill a spiritual revival from happening for God's people. Take a stand. Do what's right in God's eyes, and you'll never regret obeying God. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Listen to me close. Going to ask our music team to get ready for our invitational hymn. And perhaps today, maybe there might be someone here, and I don't know your heart, but Jesus does. And maybe here today you realize, you know what? I don't need to play church. I know about the Lord, but I don't know if I really know the Lord. There's a difference. A lot of people know about the Lord, but they don't know the Lord. There's some famous people on the earth. I know about them, but I don't know them. I never met them. But I know Jesus. I met him when I was an 8-year-old boy, November 8, 1970. I came under conviction that I was lost, and I was on my way to hell. And I was, my third grade teacher at Bible Baptist Day School presented the gospel, and I prayed right then and said, Lord, I confess I'm a sinner, and I need you to save my soul. And from that day forward, my life was changed because I accepted Jesus. Jesus came into my heart. Have I been perfect? Absolutely not. None of us can. But I've been saved, I've been forgiven, and I have been able to grow in the Lord. I've been able to learn from times that I have not obeyed the Lord. But you know what I love? Once you're saved, you're always saved. You can't lose what Jesus did for you. I'm so thankful for that, because he's faithful to us, even when we're not faithful to him. Now, that should not motivate you to sin. That should motivate you to do what's right in the eyes of the Lord. So if the Lord's convicting you about an idol in your life today, because Jesus hasn't been first and foremost in your life or in your home, you got to take care of that. That don't mean you can't have fun. Doesn't mean you can't do your hobbies. Doesn't mean you can't do those things you enjoy. It just means you just don't want that to take place of Jesus being first in your life. Make sure he's first. Because when he's first, not just on Sunday, but every day, you will see a big change in your life. It's amazing. When you face the challenges, when you face the heartbreaks, and I've had my share of them, it's a peace that comes on you, a strength you didn't even know you had. It comes just when you need it. God's always our refuge and strength and ever-present help. But if you don't know God, you don't have that benefit. But you can know him. Right there at your pew, all you got to do is say, Lord Jesus, I confess that I'm a sinner. I realize today I've been playing religion. I've been thinking I was good enough. I was looking at other folks saying, well, I'm not as bad as so-and-so. It ain't got nothing to do with that. It's got, do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? If you ask Jesus in your heart, that's what puts your name on the Lamb's Book of Life. If I never see you again, we'll see each other in heaven. Now, once you're saved, your name's in the Lamb's Book of Life. Unless you die or you have some physical handicap that you can't physically be baptized, your next step is to be baptized, just like you saw today. That's part of your obedience. That doesn't save you, but it is a testimony of your salvation. Jesus said to be baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. That is an act of obedience. And for a believer, that's not an option. That's an obligation to be obedient to God. God wants you to be part of a church. He wants you to affiliate with a church because that's part of your duty and obligation as a Christian. Again, that doesn't save you, but it's a testimony that you're saved. Maybe you're here today and you want to come to this altar, stand or kneel. Maybe you don't have the ability to kneel. You got some knee or hip problems. God understands that. But if you want to come to this altar, stand or kneel, and just do some personal inventory. Say, Lord, you convicted me about some things in my life today that I didn't realize was an idol. And I'm guilty. Lord, I'll confess it to you today. And I want to leave here today. I want to make sure you're always first on the throne of my heart. And in the throne of my home, I want to be the best husband I can be, the best wife I can be, the best parent, the best grandparent, the best employer. I want to be the best Christian I can be, not for me, but for you, Lord. Help me walk in the light as you are in the light. Help me recognize those things I need to say no to and resist and flee from. You tell us in your word what to do. Help me obey it. Maybe that's your prayer today. If you need me to pray with you, I'd be honored to. But you can go straight to God. So I'm going to pray. We're going to stand and have a hymn of invitation. God's tugging your heart to make a decision today publicly. Come on the very first verse. Oh, Holy Spirit, Father, we just pray you take this time of invitation. I pray hearts have been tenderized. We thank you, Lord, for what we've learned from Gideon. Lord, how you took a man that was not sure of himself. But Lord, you have already given him these little victories already and getting him better for bigger victories ahead. But because he's honored you, he had to clean up his own home first. What a message to us. We've got to clean up our own life or we can worry about somebody else's. So Lord, help us do the right thing. Help us make sure that, Lord, we got you first and foremost. I pray any heart that's under conviction to be saved, that they've already called upon you right there in the pew and be willing to make it public. Any decisions that need to be made for your glory, Lord, we just pray to be done. We want your will to be done. And we just want to rejoice in whatever that is. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.